Good evening, everybody. Welcome. My name is Frank Nolasco. I'm one of the vice presidents here at Curbstone Coaches, and to my right is Helene Grand Sorrento, our chairperson, our chairwoman of the organization. We've been in operation for many, many years, and this is our 52nd induction ceremony. A couple little housekeeping matters. Please turn off your cell phones. I'm sure you hear that all the time. And secondly, there are these place cards, the headers at your tables. You can put those down so you can see what's going on here. We're very proud now to have 12 inductees inducted further into the Hall of Fame here, and I think you'll enjoy this particular evening. We'll do our best to stay on schedule and keep time with you, but it's a tremendous honor that they have and a tremendous honor that they bestow upon us to do this, all right? Okay, Chuck, first off, we have attorney Lou Schiavone being escorted by Greg Kitka. Next we have Grandmaster Samuel Maples, escorted by James Tusson. Next we have Lynn Holman, escorted by Bill Safera. Next, we have Kurt Baker, escorted by Bill Chambers. Next, we have Roger Krebs, escorted by Jim Pepperney. Next we have Patrick Lowry, escorted by Larry Green. Next we have Jim Snowden, escorted by Bob Santor. Next we have Terry Hefke, escorted by Patricia Shuley. Next we have Diane Rappage-Costco, escorted by Michael Miller. Next we have Rick King, escorted by John Mang. Next we have Leo Hawkins, escorted by Dan Watton. And now we have Joe Jeswal, escorted by Ken Jeswal. So much, and we'll proceed with the evening. Please enjoy yourselves, and we'll turn it over to Tom. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. At this time, I'd like to call Pastor Dave Watkins from Crossroads Church for the invocation.
Would you bow your heads with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, we come tonight thanking you so much for this organization. And the great legacy of athletics in the Mahoning Valley. We thank you for all of these inductees tonight, their accomplishments, the inspiration they are to those who have seen their legacy and can draw from it. God, I pray that you would bless this evening, all the festivities, and we just thank you for the honor of being here to witness this evening, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Dave. At this time, we'd like the crowd to stand up for the National Anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance together. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. Thank you, everybody, for attending tonight. Welcome to the 52nd Annual Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony. Before we start our program, I want to remember somebody first before we do. This past week, if you all know by now, you heard about it, it's been in the paper, we lost our president, President Joe Maxson. Joe was a funny guy. I mean, he always had comedy about him. He was professional when he had to be. He knew when he can laugh. He knew when he can love. We all miss him. One person called him our rock in the ocean. He was that solid. I remember the first time I met him back in 2000, he comes up to me and goes, "My man, Tom Miller, how are you?" And for the next 19 years, 80% of the time, it's been, "My man, Tom Miller, how are you?" And we missed him. He always had a good prayer before our meals on Mondays. He always had trivia, and he always ended up with a good joke, too. And sometimes Joe can be talking to you seriously, and all of a sudden, he'll slip a punchline in there and make you laugh, and it would just he was just that kind of guy. His family is here tonight. I'm sure Grandpa, Dad, is watching from heavens above. And knowing Joe, he's probably looking down on me right now saying, "Tom, wrap it up and start the program already." So with that, I'll do that. I'd like the moment of silence for Joe, please. Rest in peace, Joe. We love you. We're going to miss you. Like I said, we're the Curbstone Coaches. And for a lot of you coming to our banquet for the first time, a lot of people ask us if we are coaches. And the fact of the matter is, out of our membership of about 50 to 60 people, I think we have maybe four or five current or retired coaches. We meet on Mondays at the Avion Banquet Center on Western Reserve Road over in Canfield. We get there about 11:45. We have lunch at 12 to 12:30. We do curbstone business for about 5-10 minutes. We have a speaker, usually a local or regional sports related speaker. And then after that, we have question and answer. And after that, we wrap it up. We're usually out of there by 1 to 1:15. So if anyone ever wants to come out, our notices are in the papers. Come out and join us. You don't have to be a coach. Just have to be a sports fan, like we're all sport fans. Tonight, my co-chair, Helene, this is our fourth year together. She's going to be, I can't say her age, on June 16th, though. And we work together, and I love you. Thanks for all the help you did. Next one I want to thank, we lost our ticket man last year, Mariel, and we kind of put it out there for someone to take, and Patty Shuley took it, and she took off running with it, and I want to thank her for a wonderful job she did for the tickets this year. She was assisted by Jeannie Tassone and Mike Murray. Patty, thanks a million for what you did. Frank Nolasco, who was out here before and he started the program, he's the one responsible for putting the ads together It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Every year he puts his program together, 100 and some pages. I don't know his secret. I don't know how he does it, but I want to thank Frank for the wonderful job he did on the souvenir programs. And all of you who bought ads this year, quite a few of you out there bought ads. I really want to thank you for that as well. For the inductees up front here, and for John, you too, Shaky Hill Productions, in about 2 weeks, I'm going to have a DVD of the show tonight, the program, and I'll be mailing that to you, and that'll probably be the last mail you get from me. I've been communicating with these guys for the last 5 or 6 months, and I finally got to meet all of them tonight, and it's just a beautiful group. We have proclamations in front of you also, you inductees and John. We have one from the great state of Ohio, from Senator Rooley. I want to thank Senator Rooley. And we have one from the Mahoning County Commissioner's Office. I want to thank Carol, Anthony, and Dave for that. So with that, I'd like to introduce tonight's Master of Ceremonies, and he will introduce our keynote speaker and also our inductees. We'd like to get going. Today's Master of Ceremonies certainly is no stranger to the Mahoning Valley. He was born and raised in Newcastle, Pennsylvania, and graduated from Slippery Rock University with a degree in communications. He came to work at WYTV Channel 33 in 1989 and served as a sports director for 20 years. In 28, he started at the United Way of Youngstown, where today he is the president and chief professional officer of the United Way of Youngstown in the Mahoning Valley. You may recognize him from Saturdays in the fall on Radio 57 WKBN as the voice of Youngstown State University football for the past 31 years. Let's give a warm Curbstone welcome for Bob Hannon.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks, Tom. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Always a pleasure to be here. You know, I've been able to come the past couple decades to do this event. Really only missed one. That was last year when my daughter was graduating from Ohio State, and there was a conflict, and Dana Balish filled in and obviously did a great job. I was a little nervous because the following week, everybody told me how good a job Dana did, and I know if they'd have me back next year, so I'm glad I'm back. If I can always count on you, Dana, that's for sure. One quick Joe Maxson story. Every Tuesday, when I began doing Youngstown State football, we had a press conference at noon, and President Trestle's here. We used to have it inside. We'd bring in media, anybody who wanted to come. So we'd have that press conference, and afterwards, like clockwork, every Tuesday at about 2 o'clock, I'd get a call from Joe, and he'd want to talk about the previous game. And then he'd give me questions that he would want me to ask President Trestle, then Coach Trestle, that I didn't have the courage to ask. Okay? But it was every Tuesday for about 10, 12 years he would call. When Coach Trestle was there, we'd talk on Tuesdays. And at this event, he'd always tell me beforehand, keep it moving. Keep it moving. So I'm going to try to keep it moving at my best here tonight in honor of Joe, but he was the best. Certainly a pleasure and a privilege to introduce our guest speaker, and really an honor to call him a good friend, John Hirschbeck. More than 30 years, Major League umpire working in the American League from 1984 to 1999, then later working in both leagues from 2000 to 2016. His retirement, he was a crew chief. In 2000, he was elected the first president of the newly certified World Umpires Association. He retired following the 2016 season, umpiring the All-Star Game 3 times, the Division Series 10 times, ALCS 5 times, and World Series 5 times. Some of the notable games that he umpired, David Wells' perfect game against the Twins in 1998, behind the plate for Barry Bonds' 756th home run. And in the first NLDS game, he was behind the plate, the Reds-Phillies game, Roy Halladay threw a no-hitter. And that would be tough, being behind the plate for a no-hitter. Selected crew chief for the World Series 3 times, and ironically, his final major league game for John was Game 7 of the 2016 World Series between the Cubs and Indians. They didn't want you to retire because that game went on and on and on. A native of Bridgeport, Connecticut, he began umpiring in senior year in high school. And how he got started, he didn't have enough money to go to the prom, so he started umpiring for $5 a game and got the money to go to the prom, and that was the beginning. He and his brother Mark were the first brothers to umpire in the major leagues from 1988 to 2003. His wife Denise is here tonight as well. Both John and Denise are very active with the Magic of Michael Foundation. Daughter Erin, who's also here tonight, serves as the president, spending countless hours to ensure the success of needy children in Northeast Ohio, funding organizations like the United Way, Boys and Girls Club, Akron Children's Hospital, among others. And this year's Magic of Michael event will take place July 8th at the Lake Club with former Cleveland Indian first baseman designated hitter Andre Thornton serving as a guest speaker. So if you really think about it, how hard it is to get to the professional leagues, baseball, football, basketball, whatever. It is even harder to get there as an umpire. And John was able to do it. Not only did he get there, he's a Hall of Fame umpire. He's just really one of the best that's ever been there. And when I reached out to him to do this event, he said, no problem. Just a great guy. We're proud and lucky to have him here in the Mahoning Valley, living in Poland. How about a big hand for our guest speaker, former Major League umpire, John Hirschbeck.
Thank you, sir. You got it.
Bob, thank you very much for that great introduction. You know, it's not often that I go somewhere, and that's why I like to come to things like this when I get the opportunity, that people applaud me. So while you're sitting there, on the count of three, I want you to all boo me, okay? One, two, three. Thank you. I see my mother-in-law over there. You got a little too excited, didn't you? A little too loud. I want to congratulate all the inductees here tonight. It's a great honor. And at this time, I would like all the husbands, wives, parents, and children of the inductees to stand up for a second. Come on, don't be shy. Okay, I just want to say, without these people and their love and support to help you accomplish all you've done, that a lot of these people would not be here at this time. So join me in a big round of applause for them. All right, I want to tell you a story about my first time in Yankee Stadium. Now, I grew up in Connecticut. My dad is 92 now. He's still a diehard. He gets grumpy if the Yankees lose to this day. So growing up, I always watched the Yankees. I opened up my first series in Toronto, 3 days, and we went to Yankee Stadium. So my first plate job in Yankee Stadium, to say I was nervous is an understatement. You got Billy Martin. This was 1983. Billy Martin in one dugout, and they're playing the Red Sox, Ralph Houk in the other dugout. So the first inning goes by quick. The Red Sox come up 1-2-3. Next inning, the second hitter is Dave Winfield. Now, you all remember Dave Winfield, Hall of Fame guy, 6'6", probably 240 pounds, just a big, strong athlete. So the first pitch comes in on Dave, right at the knees, a fastball, whack! Could have been a ball, could have been a strike. So I say, strike one. And he steps back and he just glares at me. He says, listen, buddy, I don't know where you came from or what you're doing here, but up here, they don't call that pitch on me a strike. You got it? I'm like, oh my God, is this what my career is gonna be like? So the next pitch comes in, it's an obvious ball, it's way outside. So it's one ball, one strike. Next pitch comes in, right at the knees again, a fastball, whack. And I go, two. And he looks at me and says, two what? I said, too low, Dave, much too low. People often ask me how I get into umpiring. There is one error in the program. One of my friends here said to me, they said you played college baseball at Central Connecticut. Take a Sharpie and cross that out. Never even came close. But actually, being an athlete, I was a basketball player in high school. I even have my own nickname, Airball. Baseball was not my game either. The last time I played, I was 12 years old. And I still remember his name on another team in the league. His name was Ken Hoboken, threw gas. I bet it was every bit of 37, 38 miles an hour. So how did I get into umpiring? As Bob mentioned, I was my senior year looking for money to go to the prom, and a guy in town said, well, if you umpire Little League Baseball, we'll pay you. And I thought, okay, that's good. And I really enjoyed it. So the following year in college, I took a test and joined a high school association. Going through college, I continued to do that. And I always say it sounds corny, but watching games on TV and watching the umpires now, I thought, I wonder how they ever get to do it at that level. And I found out that there was a school in Florida. So the middle of my senior year, I went down, attended the school, and I did quite well. And I was really fortunate that I spent 7 years in the minor leagues. And my dad had always told me, as I was going about this, he always said, do what makes you happy. Do in life what you're really happy doing, and then that way you won't mind going to work every day and you'll love your job. And I feel like I was very, very fortunate to be in that role. Now, people say, do you miss it now? And I say no, because after 41 years, you know, everything I have in life is because of it. But another thing I learned in the minor leagues is that the big difference between, everybody's supposed to be good at balls and strikes, safes and outs. When they say he's a good umpire, well, you're supposed to be a good umpire. But a lot of it's handling, like anything in life, handling people and handling situations. One time, I was working in Seattle. I had just become a crew chief. It was in 2000. So I'm basically in charge of what goes on the field. And a partner of mine, C.B. Buckner, misses a play at first base, and Lou Piniella was managing the Mariners at the time. So Lou comes out, and he goes absolutely crazy. Takes his hat, throws it, takes it a second time, throws it, kicks it three more times, picks up the first base bag, throws that into right field. Finally, I get the chance, and I come over, and I slide in between he and CB, and I said, Lou, and he looked at me, he goes, what? I said, his wife is Karen. I said, do you know what Karen's gonna say to you tonight when she sees the way you're acting on TV? And he said, oh, you're right. And he turns around and walks away. So we come off the field later, in the locker room, they have the interview going on, and the sports announcer says, what did Hirschbeck say to you? He just reminded me how stupid I looked and what my wife was gonna do to me when I got home tonight. People ever ask me, does a manager ever come out and say, hey, I want you to throw me out? It's only happened to me once in my career. And it's a very dear friend of our family. His name is Ron Gardenhier. He's the Detroit Tiger manager now. At the time, he was manager of the Minnesota Twins. So working in Minnesota, and this was 2014, my son Michael was still alive, and they were best friends. I mean, they were literally speed dial with each other. Michael would call him, and he would call Michael all the time. So that day, I'm at second base, and there's a runner on first. So now I'm in the middle of the infield. My partner, James Hoy, is at third. There's a short fly ball at the left field, so he runs out to see whether or not it was a catch or no catch. He calls it a catch, and Ron Gardenhier comes running out, and he goes by me, and he goes, I don't believe this. And he goes right on by me to James Hoy, and he starts arguing with him. So after about 2 minutes, that's a long time when you're standing out there with everybody watching you, he comes back by me and he says, you're gonna have to throw me out. I said, I'm not throwing you out. He said, no, you're gonna have to throw me out. I said, go argue with him. I don't feel like writing the report. I'm not throwing you out. He said, yes, you are. I said, okay, Ron, do you realize if I throw you out of a game, what my son Michael's gonna say to me? He goes, I'll take care of that. I said, no, I'm not throwing you out. And he said, John, there's 40,000 people here. There's all these people watching on TV. All my players saw what happened. I have to get thrown out of this game. So finally I said, all right, I'll do it. And so I throw him out. He turns around and he says, guess where I'm going? I said, to the locker room. He goes, nope, I'm going right to the phone. I'm calling Michael and tell him what you did to me. True story. Another important lesson I've learned along the way is that you can learn from anyone in life. If we keep an open mind and we keep a positive attitude, you can learn from anyone. And you never know when that person's gonna come along and give you something, no matter what you do, that you might be able to learn from. And mine happened in the 1995 World Series. I had the van loaded up with the kids. We're heading to Pittsburgh to fly to Atlanta, where game one was gonna be played. Kids are in the car, my wife, my mother and father-in-law. As I'm backing down our driveway in Poland, our dumpster was out the night before, and I see a long piece of cardboard sticking out of it. So I stop the van, I get out, I take the cardboard, and I look at it. It says, to John, good luck at the show. We'll be watching you. P.S. Lofton loves to steal third. You're trash men. So I'm like, boy, that was really nice. I didn't even know they knew I lived here. You know, they come like 4:30 in the morning. And so I take it and I said, I gotta save this. So I throw it in the van. And that night, or the next day, we were flying in that day. So the next day is game one of the World Series. And I was starting at third base. So what happens is you go third, second, first, plate, and then to the lines if it goes game six and seven. So I'm at third. First hitter for the Indians is Kenny Lofton. He gets a base hit, so he's on first. The next hitter, Carlos Baerga, comes up, and he hits a ground ball to second, but Lofton was running, so there's no chance to get him at second base. So they throw to first. We got one out in the World Series, and Lofton's at second. And I'm standing there, and I look down. I go, no. There's no way in the first inning of the World Series with his speed that he's ever going to run. I said, but just in case they were right, let me inch up just a little bit here. So I kind of inched up some baby steps closer to third base. Next pitch, the next hitter's on the way. And I look out of the corner of my eye, and I go, oh, my God, he's running. So thankfully, I was like right there at third base, and I make the call. And the next day, there's a picture in the Sporting News of Chipper Jones holding the glove up. Kenny Lofton went in with his left hand. But if you remember back in the day, if you follow the Indians, he pulled his left hand back, and he would come in with his right. And because I had it on my mind, the worst thing you can do in umpiring is anticipate and call something too quick. And there was a picture in the Sporting News with Chipper Jones holding the glove up, and Kenny Lofton was hand looking at me. And me, and if you look closely, my hand's like this, but my right hand was like this. I was getting ready to call him out, and I did call him safe. So to this day, I thank God for my trash men. Because it would have been hell to have to go miss a call, and imagine missing a call in the first inning, and then having to go second, first, plate. I mean, there's no telling how many I could have missed in that series. I've never wished my life away, ever, but I am happy my career started. I got to the big leagues in 1983, and it finished in 16. It's a whole different game nowadays. We had a lot more fun back then. And in 2016, my last year, it was in July. I was up in Toronto working. And the bat boy there has been there for a long time. He's probably like 24, 25 years old. His name is John, too. Really a nice young man. So the Indians were getting beat 17-1. So they take their catcher, Chris Jimenez, terrific guy. And Terry Francona decides to pitch him for the last two innings, just so he doesn't want to blow his bullpen any more than he already had. So the idea is just put a catcher out there. He can throw strikes, and we'll get out of here, you know, two innings, six quick outs. So as Chris goes by me, he said, now, Hershey, don't squeeze me. I'm not getting paid extra for this. So I'm thinking, like, all right, I can't just call, like, pitches that are off a little bit. 17-1, no one cares, even this day and age. But then I blow my score because it's all computerized now, and you miss 10 pitches in the last two innings. There goes your score. So I thought, okay, I'm going to try and have some fun here. So the first hitter, excuse me, this is the eighth inning. Troy Tulowitzki comes up, and I said, listen, we're going to play a game. I said, if I call a strike on you, if it's a strike, I call strike, and you don't swing, it's $20 for every one. I said, are you in? He goes, yeah, I'll play. So I did it for all the six hitters. And there were a few called strikes. So next time I go back to Toronto in September, and I said, hey, John, how'd you make out? And he goes, John, you're not going to believe it. They came over with an envelope for $140 for me. So you'll never hear about stuff like that happening anymore. I told you earlier that I haven't gotten much applause in my life, and I really didn't get much good fan mail throughout the years. But I want to share something with you that I got. It was about 2 months after the 16 World Series was over, so I was retired. Let's see here. Don't laugh. I'm an umpire. I need glasses. It says, now this came to me 2 months, I'm home, it's winter time. Dear Mr. Hirschbeck, you don't know us, but we wanted to thank you for the part you played in the great news we were able to share with our family and friends this week. The rain delay you called in Game 7 of the World Series added even more suspense to one of the most dramatic sports events we have ever witnessed. We tried to take our minds off things for that grueling 17 minutes, by taking a shot at starting a family. It worked. Thanks so much for the nudge. Love, Brad and Cassie. P.S., we hope you're enjoying retirement. And they sent me a picture of the sonogram. So, I know we don't want to take up a lot of time. Hopefully I haven't been too long. I just want to say this in parting, that we can't all get into the Hall of Fame. We can't all make it to the big leagues, but we can all live our lives like big league people. So thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, and God bless.
Great job.
Thanks.
Okay, you guys ready to induct? Let's start the induction ceremony now with Bob Hand to the start.
John, great job, and keep up the great work with the Magic of Michael Foundation, all that you're doing. Before I begin with the first inductee, and just want a couple things I want to mention. In the program is the complete bio, so if you want to take a look at that, I'm going to edit it down, respectful of everybody's time. But there's one person that does so much work for this. I get the privilege to really read some of the highlights of this great class, but someone did all the legwork, and it wasn't me. And had to go make the phone calls and do the digging. If we could have a hand, he's over here to my far left in the corner for Greg Gullis. Greg, great job again this year with all the bios. Our first inductee is Patrick Lorelli, one of two contributors in this year's class. A 1958 graduate of Wilson High School and a 1986 graduate of Youngstown State. Patrick was recruited by St. Christine Schools to serve as their first athletic director. Under his direction, he started a fifth and sixth grade football team, also serving as coach. Over the next decade, his teams won four consecutive league championships, finishing as runner-up on three other occasions. His goal was to emulate the school's seventh and eighth grade teams as well. His teams went on to win multiple league titles at one time, capturing six consecutive championships and pulling off a number of undefeated campaigns. The boys' basketball and track and field teams also won league championships on many occasions. With no sports offered for girls, Patrick wished that they could be able to compete and participate. He was the driving force behind starting a girls' basketball program and track and field as well. It wasn't always about athletics either. He instituted a program titled Academic Excellence in Sports, which awarded the boy or girl with the highest cumulative grade point average a plaque for their efforts. He spent 12 years in Little League and Pony League as a coach, and he also had the unique opportunity to coach all four of his sons. Our first inductee under contribution to sports, Patrick Lorelli.
How do you follow that guy? I don't have those kind of stories. But this is awesome. To be recognized for something I love to do. First of all, I'd like to thank my sponsor, Larry Green. Larry and I go back to high school. I won't tell you how many years ago that was, but we've been friends ever since, and he's a great guy. Also, this is a major event in my life and a high honor, and I thank the Curbstone Coaches for that. You know, they've been around over 50 years, and every year they get better and better, as you could see. The journey started when my boy said, Dad, could we play Little League? I said, absolutely. So I sat down with my wife and we start talking about it. And I said, the boys want to play baseball, but I want to coach them. And she said, well, I think that's great. And I said, well, you know, I'll get a chance to spend more time with them. So I did. I asked her if she was all in and she said, absolutely. So when we come home from practices, summer or winter, there was always a hot meal on the stove. When it came time for game time, the uniforms were always washed, clean, and ready to go. And she never, ever missed a game. Fantastic. Without that kind of love and support, I don't think I'd be here tonight. Being the first AD for St. Christine's was a blessing for me because I loved the school and I loved the church. I did what I could. I was called in by the pastor, and he said, Patrick, what are you going to do? I said, I don't know, Father. I never did this before. I said, I'll do my best. So he said, there's one thing you cannot ask me for. And I said, what's that? He said, money. And I never, ever did, because we had a fantastic booster club, second to none. Whatever I asked them for, they went out and worked and got it, and usually it was a lot of money. Matter of fact, the booster president at that time was Tom Orsini. And Tom's here tonight. Tom, stand up and take it, Bob, please. Tom, there he is. Very hardworking booster club, and they were able to facilitate whatever I needed for all our programs. Also tonight, we have one of the original coaches for the girls basketball team. He was a stabilizing force in that, and he's here tonight. Lou DeMarinas, please stand up or wave your hand, Lou. There he is. Thank you, Lou. I have some people to thank, and I won't take a long time, but one of them is the Sisters of Charity. We had nuns then. They were revered. They were very strict, very hard, but I found them to be very caring and cooperative. We worked to have the kids focus on their academics, not only on their sports, and it worked very well. Most of them got through it, and if they didn't, we'd get them on the right track. There are some key people that I want to thank that helped this program through. They're not with us anymore, but I do want to recognize them. One of them is Pat Ortenzio. We call him Super Booster. He could sell snow to Eskimos. That's how good he was. Also, Terry Taylor, my assistant head coach. He was great with the kids, and he was my mentor, and he taught me a lot. We had a fellow named John Pappy D. McCalla. He was our equipment manager. There wasn't anything he could not fix. And those kind of people you need on your program to help things go along. To my sons, I was blessed to be your dad, but I was privileged to be your coach in sports and in life. They trusted me, they believed in me, and they laid the foundation for who they are today. They're men of honor. Not only that, they blessed Grandma and I with 14 grandchildren, and it doesn't get any better than that. Thank you.
Our second inductee tonight is Roger Krebs. You might say that Roger just ran his way into the Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame. Boardman High School graduate, multi-sport athlete, where he earned 11 overall letters. But he enters the hall tonight for his outstanding work in track and field, but he also was an outstanding basketball player. As a track standout, Roger set a new school standard in the mile run, 880 run, mile relay, and 2 mile events and broke all school records. During his junior and senior years, he was undefeated in dual and triangular meets in the mile and half mile runs. In most of those meets he participated in, he broke existing SBC records. He beat Olympic champion Dave Waddle in the mile run at the Pittsburgh Tri-State Coaches Meet to win that event and the district champion in the 880 run his senior year. At the age of 15, Roger recorded the nation's fastest time in the half mile and was awarded the hardest worker on the team. He won the mile at the Rayan Invitational as well. He was the state champion in the junior JC track championships and the 120-yard low hurdles, twice winning the state title in the 880-yard run. In cross country, he set New Still Valley Conference, Mahoning Valley District, and Braceville Invitation records as well. Upon graduation, Roger attended Ashland University on a track cross-country scholarship and participated in many events in both squads. His senior year, maybe he must have got a little bit bored, he decided to go out for the golf team. In his first round, he shot a 74. That's just not fair to shoot a 74, Roger, your first time out. He coached track and cross country for 16 years, serving as the head coach cross country team for 7 seasons. He was voted Mahoning Valley Coach of the Year in 1977. Our second inductee, Roger Krebs.
Well, I'm really honored to be here tonight and to be part of this event. I want to thank a few of my closest people to me, my wife Mary Ann, and my daughters Natalie and Tiffany, and Steve Mowry, my brother Ron and his wife Karen, and my best friend Jay Fabian and his wife Sherry. I'm going to share with you a few memories about my guest also at this time. In high school, Pete Galgen was my coach. And we would meet at Boardman Park, of all places, and that's where we'd run from the old, well, the old high school now, and out to the Boardman Park to the flagpole. And that's where we'd meet and decide what we were going to do that day for running. And one day, I said, hey, I want to run in my bare feet. The coach says, Roger, yeah, I don't know. He says, all right. I was really persistent, because he used to let him do run 100-yard dashes on the football stadium. So I did do it, and it worked out. I will say I did better than if I didn't have those shoes. Okay, also, when I was being, excuse me one second here. Neil Williams, that's who I want to talk about. Gosh, how many, anybody in this audience know Neil Williams? Did they recognize that name, Neil Williams? He was a Boardman coach many years, 50 years ago. Anyways, he would bring me home from track practice every night because it was on his way. So I really enjoyed that because I could talk to him about, not just track, we could talk about things in life. And he was a mentor for me, and I really looked up to him. When I was, one other thing I wanted to mention too is about Ashland University. I was recruited at Ashland University, and my parents had to go to the school there, and we visited with the coach for a whole day. And we got in the car, and we coming back from Ashland. My mom turned around and said, you better go to Ashland. I said, yeah, okay. So that's what I did. I ended up enrolling into Ashland University and had a scholarship to help me out. And I'll continue. Let's see. Thanks. You know, okay. In closing, I'd like to mention that throughout my athletic achievements, and I appreciate the support of my late parents, Dorothy and Jack Krupps. Thanks again to the Curbstone Coaches for holding this enshrinement, and it's an evening I will not forget. And I'd also like to mention my sponsor, Jim Pepperny. I want to thank you, Jim, I am so excited about being a member of this group. Thanks. Yeah, thank you.
Our next inductee, Kirk Baker, for football, one of the finest all-around athletes ever to come out of Jackson Milton, earned letters in both football and basketball for the Blue Jays during his career, earned All-State honors as a senior, and as a sophomore was honorable mention selection. He earned the team's Offensive Lineman Award his sophomore year and Defensive Back Award his senior season. During both his sophomore and senior year, he was named All-Northeastern Ohio. Upon graduation, he established new standards for most career receptions, most career receiving yards offensively, and defensively his records included most career interceptions and tackles for loss. Well, you are ready to go, aren't you? In basketball, he was a four-year letter winner and All-ITCL selection during both his junior and senior seasons. For the past 22 years, he's been a football official, a softball and baseball coach in Canfield for over 15 years. He guided the 9-10 girls softball team to the state championship. And he's done a terrific job, Kirk, as the superintendent of Jackson Milton Schools the past 10 years. Our third inductee, Kirk Baker.
Thank you very much. Looking around me, I'm not only in awe, but I'm extremely grateful to be here this evening. Our Valley is very fortunate to have an organization like the Curbstone Coaches. It, through their meetings on a weekly basis and all the hard work they do, they keep us extremely excited about all of the athletics in the Mahoning Valley. Athletics has been kind of an integral part of my life, making me extremely honored to be here tonight to the 52nd annual Curbstone Coaches ceremony. In retrospect, my parents, they were amazing. They were one of my great fan club, wonderful support group. And I actually remember when I was about 8 years old, my dad, he was kind of a carpenter on the side. He built me this wooden goalpost. So we used to go out there every night and kick and play catch, and he'd play catch with the baseball with me. My mom, she was like kind of like my cheerleader. She would make sure I was at practice at time. She'd take me to get my equipment, and she would always make me pasta the night before all the big games. High school at Jackson Milton, to me, was extremely awesome. I was very fortunate to be surrounded by great teammates that I still am friends with today, a lot of them, and great coaches. As for coaches, I was kind of blessed to have Jim Pepperney, who Mr. Krebs mentioned, and he's here this evening. Where is Jim Pepperney? Where you at? Stand up. There you go. Come on. So I was fortunate to have Jim Pepperney for basketball for 4 years. Coaches like Tony Vicarelli, Ralph Misko, Dick Murray, Joe Smick, Ted Rupert, Dan Withers, Joe Bertolini, and I was surrounded by a gentleman named Jim Cullen. Worked with him at Jackson Milton for a long time, so appreciate everything you've done for me. And they all taught me how to work hard, respect the game, enjoy the game, and just to have some fun with it. I was also fortunate, I'm still fortunate to be associated with sports. I referee football, officiate basketball, and as mentioned, I'm superintendent at Jackson Milton, and I get the best seat in the house when I go to the game. I'm surrounded by great staff out there. I have some staff members here. I'm surrounded by great students. Parents are great, and Lake Milton, North Jackson area is a great community. In closing, I would like to thank everyone for being here today, especially my wife, Lisa, my in-laws, Jim and Barb Huffman, my friends, my kids, and all of those of you who took the time to be a positive influence in my life. Lost my last page, I think. Hang on. Nope, I got it. I do want a special thanks to my friend and colleague, Bill Chambers, who nominated me this evening. He's here. Special thanks to the Curbstone Coaches. Again, they do wonderful things and help spread all the great things with athletics in the Valley. And I feel very fortunate to be inducted with such a wonderful and gifted group of athletes. So once again, thank you very much.
Len Holman, a 1971 graduate of East Palestine High School, this year's special award inductee, served as his valedictorian of his graduating class. While at East Palestine, he was a three-year winner for the Bulldogs in football and a three-year two-way starter and middle linebacker and guard, and doing all of this at 165 pounds. He also played basketball for three seasons, an all Tri-County League football selection during his junior and senior seasons as well. He earned all Columbiana County honors as a sophomore, junior, and senior. Upon graduation, Len went on to Ohio Northern University, where as a freshman he played both linebacker and defensive back for the Polar Bears. After coaching and parenting for his daughters through 12 years of travel in high school, he became a softball umpire, and at eight, Len has spent 46 years in stripes as a football and basketball official, spending another 8 seasons on the softball diamond. He's made many profound and significant contributions to the Youngstown District Football Officials Association. He served as vice president, president, and past president. He served on the ethics committee, nominating committee, executive committee, and code of regulations and education committee. Under special award into the Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame, Len Holman.
Bob, thank you for that warm introduction. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am truly honored, humbled, and privileged to be named as a 2019 inductee to the Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame. I'm overwhelmed to have the opportunity to join the tremendous athletes, coaches, assigners, fellow officials who have served as my role models, my mentors, and my peers. I would also like to congratulate this outstanding class of inductees for 2019. There are many of you in the room tonight that are responsible for me being up here in front of you. Thank you all so much for supporting my induction through your attendance and through your advertising and for being here tonight. I would especially like to thank Bill Safara for submitting my nomination and for sponsoring me in my induction, as well as Tony Montana and Pat Montana for their assistance. I'd also like to thank the Curbstone coaches, the members, the selection committee, the banquet committee, and especially Greg Goulis and Frank Nolasco for their patience with me as we got everything ready for this evening. All of us in this room have made sacrifices in our professional and personal lives to coach and officiate. In my case, none have borne the burden of the sacrifice enabled me to pursue my professional and vocational goals and objectives more than my family. My loving wife, Kathy, daughter, Holly, son-in-law, Brian, and my sons, James and David. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for your enduring love, ongoing understanding, continual support, and commitment. Words can't express what this has meant to me in those endless nights away from home pursuing my vocation. There comes a time when every athlete realizes that they can no longer continue to perform on the field with the games that they grew up with and the sports that they love. So they're faced with a decision. Do I continue to try to do that sport at a different level? Or do I become forever a spectator? Or do I find a way to remain in the game? For me, that time came at Ohio Northern University when the OAC in my sophomore year decided that if you didn't have a financial need, you couldn't have an academic or an athletic scholarship. So I decided to focus on academics and move forward by taking classes and officiating both football and basketball. Earning $33 on a Thursday night for three games in an adult vocational league in 1972 was pretty good money for a college student. In fact, it was so long ago when I started, the penalty flag was red my first year, and not the gold flag that we have today. After graduating from Ohio Northern, I embarked on my pharmacy career, and you can see from my bio, both in retail pharmacy, hospital pharmacy, home infusion pharmacy, and specialty pharmacy. But what happened was I got to get involved in leadership roles in different boards. And my mentor taught me a lot of things about the principles of orchestration. Preparation, preparation, preparation. When there's a meeting, know every item on the agenda. Know the answer to every question before it's going to even be asked. Know what's really important during that meeting, what to fall on your sword for, and what to concede on. Know what's important to each and every person in that room so that you know and know what you need to do behind the scenes so that you can get the desired outcome. I was able to apply these principles that I learned in my career. And during that time, I was sometimes affectionately referred to as Preparation H. You know, always being prepared for meetings, taking copious notes, never forgetting or throwing anything away, as well as a play on my last name. However, when this term of endearment was applied to me, much like the ointment, I was probably more the source of the irritation rather than the remedy. Some might even consider me to be a perfectionist. You know, if it's not worth doing well, it's not worth doing at all. Anyway, as I move forward on being on all these different boards, I was able to apply these skills to our local associations of both football and basketball and made significant impacts and contributions on the organization's operations, structure, code of regulations, mentoring, and education functions. Also, we developed a reputation within our football crew for having outstanding pregame conferences. My crew is all here tonight, and you can see in the program that we're blessed to have people with great longevity on that crew. My experiences have afforded me great opportunity to meet outstanding people, student athletes, coaches, assigners, school administrators, and fellow officials who have worked at every level. In fact, John and I even used to work basketball together many years ago. I've developed lifelong friendships through these relationships. However, we need your help. Sports officiating is at a crossroads for the future of interscholastic contests as we know it today. Not long ago, I chaired an education committee for the Youngstown District Football Association. We had 15 members show up, and it was the longest. This is the longest. It was the most members we ever had. I asked if you would raise your hand if you're under 50. Only one person raised their hand. So this is definitely the graying of America that we see happening with us. There have been numerous reports in the media about the difficulties being experienced to recruit new officials. There are many reasons for this: sportsmanship of everyone involved, the threat of violence, verbal abuse, time commitment, perceived low pay, initial limited room for advancement, and applying unrealistic expectations, to begin to name a few. There's an urgent need for people to step up and recruit, retain, train qualified officials. Our local officials' associations are working hard to develop and implement outreach and ongoing programs to attract, recruit, train, mentor new officials, and retain them. So please help us do so. Put yourself in the shoes of those officials working these contests. Think before you speak. Be respectful. Treat everyone involved as you would expect to be treated, and in return, we will do the same. Say yes to officiating. Thank you so much for this prestigious honor, and good night.
As it was noted at the beginning, we've been doing this event for more than 50 years. We have a first tonight. Grandmaster Samuel Naples is the first martial arts inductee. Samuel, a 1975 graduate of Cardinal Mooney High School, a native of the city's south side. It was at the age of 12 when he joined the local YMCA with a group of his friends from St. Stanislaus School and became intrigued with judo and karate programs that were being offered. He began taking kids' classes at the YMCA, eventually gravitating to adult classes with Grandmaster Chun, who continually encouraged Samuel to continue on. He attended his first tournament in Akron at the age of 14 and quickly gained his brown belt, attending 7 classes a week. Chun realized the dedication of a student and how great he could be. His second tournament as a brown belt at the Cleveland branch of the Ohio Judo and Karate Association, he placed first in forms and second in sparring in the adult division. Samuel would receive his black belt 6 months later, and over the years winning multiple tournaments both statewide and nationally. He would assist Chun during his days at Cardinal Mooney High School, and his junior year placed second in forms at historic Madison Square Garden. A hip injury curtailed Samuel's competitive career in his early 20s, so he focused on teaching with Master Chun. Owner of several schools over the years, considered one of the very best at developing instructors, he was inducted into the Bruce Lee Legends Honors Hall of Fame in Columbus. Let's welcome our first martial arts inductee, Grandmaster Samuel Naples.
First of all, I want to thank Michael Sanko, who took all of our portraits. He is like an amazing photographer, also went to St. Stan's with me. So if you're here, Michael, thank you. So in 2013, my father passed away at the age of 99. And at that time, shortly after, and while he was passing away, I was suffering from degenerative arthritis. I could barely walk. And, you know, thank God for Dr. George Phillips and Dr. Sandy Naples. They kept me moving around. So shortly after my father passed away, I was walking into a coffee shop and snow was going into my shoes because I couldn't lift my feet up. And I thought, I could live another 45 years. Do I want to spend it in a wheelchair? So though I'm a little bit stubborn, I went to Dr. Naples and I said, okay, what do we do? And he introduced me to Dr. Tim Domer. And Dr. Domer did double hip replacements, not at the same time, but double hip replacements in 2014. And my first day of physical therapy, I went to Circle Rehab and John Graff was my physical therapist. And you know, my first day moving, I went, oh my God, I can teach karate again. So that was like being reborn. So I joined the YMCA with a bunch of kids from St. Stan's. And I came from a diverse neighborhood that was Italians, Slovaks, and Polish people. And so now I go to the YMCA, and I'm taking martial arts lessons off of a Korean. I'd never seen an Oriental before, so I was as much infatuated that he wasn't, you know, an Italian as anything. But so Grandmaster Chun and Jim Evans also, they were my, you know, my main instructors at the YMCA. I had three mentors at that time who are all deceased. Laird Ekman, who was Mahoning Valley Economic Development Agency, attorney Henry DeBlasio, and Joe Maxson that passed away that week, last week. The three of them were like the senior belts. We all did get our black belts at the same time, but they were always there giving me advice, you know, as I was growing up. I was really disappointed that Joe couldn't be here today. So my freshman year in high school, the four of us actually got our black belts together. And it was about that time that I met Grandmaster Charlie Steppen. Charlie was a court reporter and on the board of directors, or I mean on the board of the Bar Association. And Charlie soon became my best friend. We traveled all over the country together. And really, I mean, I don't think I appreciated that my parents let me go all over the country because I was going around with him. I competed at Madison Square Garden four times and won three times. And then around at the age of 21, I got injured training alone for Madison Square Garden. And as my condition got worse and worse, I stopped competing. And then one tournament came up and I wasn't gonna go because it was, you know, I couldn't compete and I was a little bit depressed. And Grandmaster Chun said, why don't you go to the tournament and do what I would do, take some kids with you. So I go to the tournament. Now at that time, the front table was only Korean martial arts masters. No Americans are allowed to sit there. So very naively, I'm like about 23 or 4 years old. I walk up to the front table and I sit down. Well, all of a sudden, there's a big powwow at the other end of the table and all the Korean masters are talking. So Grandmaster Il-Ju Kim comes up to me and goes, so Sam, what are you doing here? And I said, well, sir, Grandmaster Chun said, do what he would do, so I'm waiting for somebody to give me a job. So he goes back and they all start talking again. He comes back and goes, okay, sit next to me at the microphone. And he taught me how to run martial arts tournaments. A year later, I was running Madison Square Garden. And I ran karate tournaments there and at the Trump Taj Mahal and all over the country. So truthfully, if I had never gotten injured, I probably would have not gone into, you know, becoming a judge or being able to, you know, help out at the other tournaments. So, you know, because of that, I got inducted into the All-American Open Taekwondo Tongsu Karate Kung Fu Hall of Fame in New York City at Madison Square Garden. I was inducted into the Legends of Honor. I was inducted 2 years ago into the official Taekwondo Hall of Fame. And now the Curbstone Coaches. You know, they say that you never get recognized in your own hometown. You can do great stuff all over the world, but at home nobody knows what you did. So this is like the pinnacle for me, is to be recognized in Youngstown. So thank you everybody for this honor. There's a Korean saying that you judge a tiger by its skin, which means that, you know, what you leave behind after you're gone is, you know, how you judge someone's life. So, you know, looking back a little bit, I had a lot of students that were national champions, including Karen Orwell, who's my best student, and Natalie LaRisha. I also had students that not only were great competitors, but also now have their own schools around the area. Jimmy Terlecki owns Next Level Jiu-Jitsu in Austintown. Jim Bundy owns Team Bundy in Howland. Chuck Mirza owns Grandmaster Chun Karate in Wooster, Ohio. Steve Demko owned Moon's Taekwondo in Cleveland. And Bill Kopko, who's here tonight, teaches Aikido in Newcastle. And Sherry Gallo owned North Coast Martial Arts till an illness caused her to retire. I also am grateful to have a lot of martial arts instructors that are good friends. I've met great people from all across the country, but especially here tonight, I want to thank Sifu Tom Reevely, who owns Team Office Supply, Master Darren Warren and Master Justin Taylor, who owns Junior Taekwondo. And actually, Master Taylor's school is in my old school, which is next to Jay's Hot Dogs. And I'm actually moving into one of his, he's got like three studios, so I'm gonna be teaching out of his school in the near future. So anyway, thank you, Master Taylor, for being here. May 25th will be my 50th year of doing martial arts. I started when I was 12 years old, and this will be 50 years of doing it. So really excited, we'll be doing that at Master Taylor's school. I wanna thank my friends, family, and students that are here to support me, and especially I want to thank my godfather, my 93-year-old Uncle Albert Naples, for being here. Uncle Al, would you stand up, please? And also Jim and Jeannie Tassone, who like put up with me for the last month trying to put this together. Thank you, everybody.
The Homahoning Valley has certainly had a rich history in boxing. Lou Schiavone is part of that history. 1974 graduate of Cardinal Mooney High School, Lou was the 1972 Youngstown Golden Gloves novice champion, and as a runner-up the following year. He fought for the home club under the tutelage of legendary trainer and Curbstone Coach Hall of Fame inductee Art Mayorga, taking on notable fighters such as Ron Cummings, Greg Augustine, Leslie Tony, among those during a well-documented amateur career. Then he had a decision to make, whether to turn pro or go off to college. He opted for college, getting his BA in history from The Ohio State University. He will go on to earn his law degree from the highly acclaimed Thomas Coley Law School in Lansing, Michigan. Lou, over the years, helped many notable area fighters during the course of their career, including Craig Kikta, Michael Clark, and Jamie McClendon. Lou also managed the day-to-day operations of former unified middleweight champion of the world, Kelly Pavlik, during his rise to the top of the boxing world, and had a chance to see Kelly here tonight, and Kelly's looking great. Always one to lend a helping hand when it comes to the ring game, he has promoted multiple professional fights at the Metroplex and Maronite Center. Lou also wants to preserve the area's rich boxing history. He's the past president of the Legends of Leather organization, calling it a labor of love. Let's welcome into the Hall of Fame for boxing, Lou Schiavone.
Thank you, Curbstone Coaches, for this tremendous honor. You know, congratulations to all these inductees. I'm not sure I'm worthy. I mean, these guys are really, really have performed well and done well, and their contributions are so greatly appreciated. But one can't help to appreciate the athleticism and contributions of the sport world. Take, for instance, our bowling nominee, Ms. Hefke. I mean, she's had 65 300 games. I've been bowling for 40 years. My average is 173. I've never had a 300. I just hope someday maybe I'll be able to get one. But in any event, there's a lot of people I have to thank, and I'm gonna try not to take too much time, but I have a lot of people that I owe great gratitude to. First of all, my lovely wife who's sitting there at the table. She let me love the labor of love, the sport of boxing for 40 years, something she wanted nothing to do with. She hated it. And throughout it all, I put her through a lot. First of all, she had to watch her four sons, her little baby boys. They all wanted to take after dad or their brothers, so they were kind of forced into boxing. And as a result, she had to endure some trying times. First thing she had to endure was watching her oldest boy, Joe, take four standing eight counts in the first fight in the Golden Gloves. As she was trying to film and she's holding the camera, she drops the camera, starts crying, and runs out of the gym. If that weren't bad enough, our youngest boy, Nick, he enters the KO boxing tournament, and the day before he has his graduation picture, he gets his front tooth knocked out. Oh, you want to talk about catching hell? Oh my God. She couldn't believe it. So it was a labor of love, and I appreciate her so much for putting up with some of this stuff. And next, I have to thank my four boys. They all wanted to do what Dad did. So, starting with my son Joe. Joe was the first of the four boys. He entered the Golden Gloves, and as I said, he lost his first fight. After his first fight, he looked so, you know, he was really down, and I walked up to him. I said, "Hey, Joe," I said, "just because this was a sport I participated in, that doesn't mean you have to like it." I said, "You don't have to do this." He looked me in the eyes. He goes, "Are you kidding me? I'm winning this thing next year." And he actually did. He won the Golden Gloves the next year, and I was so proud of him. My second son, Dan, was someone who really didn't want anything to do with boxing. He just decided, because of the forcefulness of myself and his older brother, Joe, that he would enter the KO tournament. He entered the KO tournament, and he performed extremely well, made it to the championship, fought really hard, and I was really, really proud of him. And we never really knew Dan's disdain for the sport until his mother and I one day were looking, and we found one of his college papers. And he wrote how I was really kind of, you know, torn about this, but my family kind of made me box, kind of wanted me to do this. It was a rite of passage. In order to be a Chavoni, I had to do this, and I did it. And I'm so proud of him that he fought so hard and did so well. But when I saw the paper, I'm really sorry, Dan. But he did get an A on the paper, so that was a good thing. My next son was Mark. Mark was 135 pounds, started at defensive end for Boardman freshman year, and all of a sudden decided he didn't want to see these pulling guards come out and crush him every play, so decided he would participate in a sport that was more suitable to his weight. From there, he basically entered the KO boxing tournament, went 7-0, never lost a fight, and did really well. I was really, really proud of him as well. And my last son, Nick, who wasn't able to make it tonight, he was funny. He's the one that looked like the jack-o'-lantern on graduation picture day. So he actually didn't want to fight either. He was a straight-A student, valedictorian of Boardman. But again, his brothers forced him in entering the tournament, KO tournament at the end, and he ended up going 4-0, making it to he was the student athlete of the week, and he was the most promising fighter of the tournament. So boys, John, I love you. Thanks for putting up with me. Boys, I'm really proud of you. And there's a few other people that I have to thank as well. Next I have to thank my parents. I would like to thank my late mom and dad, Joe and Vera Schiavone, for guiding my success and letting me fight in the Golden Gloves. A lawyer and a nurse usually would not let their son participate in such a brutal sport. My sisters are here tonight, Mary Jo, Lisa, brother-in-law Jim. They came from far away to help me celebrate this great honor. I thank them. My stepsisters, Loretta and Tina, are here along with my stepmother, who's 95 years old, Sophie Schiavone. If you want to stand up, Sophie, please do. She's still around. I'd like to thank my law partners, Joe Bush, Sean Muldowney, and office manager Terry Parker. Without them, my success would not have been possible. They held down the fort while I was running around managing and promoting, and without them, my success would not have been possible. I really thank you guys a lot. To all my friends, I mean, I'm really blessed. I got a lot of friends here tonight, and I really couldn't believe the turnout that I have, and really thank you from the bottom of my heart, guys, for all the support. I'd also like to thank my late trainer, Art Mayorga. His guidance helped me become the man I am today. He made a 16-year-old shrimpy kid a Golden Gloves champion, and I'll always be indebted to him. You know, boxing has been really good to me and my family, especially my boys. It taught them a lot of life lessons. It taught them how to work hard, how to defend oneself, how to be dedicated, how to stay in shape, and how to be compassionate. You know, training in a city gym, my son saw other kids in poverty and despair. For many, boxing is the only way out of the ghetto. It really helped them to be more compassionate for the less fortunate. It helped them become successful professionals. One's a lawyer, an appraiser, a pharmacist, and a doctor. And I think boxing really helped them steer them in the right direction. I also like to thank the person that nominated me, Cred Kid Kikta, who I managed, and we had a great time together. It was a true pleasure helping and watching him win the IBC welterweight title. Jack Lowe, Craig, and I got to travel to Vegas, Phoenix, Omaha, and LA, and Craig always made Youngstown proud. I developed a 20-year friendship with Craig that can never be broken. Kelly and Mike Pavlett, I really want to thank you guys. You guys had faith in me and appointed me to advisors Team Pavlett. Watching him win the middleweight title was a life event that I will never forget. I mean, that was a great fight. Those guys banged it out back and forth. One guy got dropped. Kelly got up and dropped him and stood him back up and put him in a corner and started pounding him. It was just something I'll never forget. In closing, two of my fondest memories were before Kelly's fight at the Covelli Center in Youngstown. We're at the Holiday Inn, and before the fight, a limo picked us up to go to the fight.
Our limo was escorted by firefighters, police officers, and on our way to the fight, I looked out the window and I saw people really running out of houses and businesses watching this and screaming and cheering us on. I mean, Kelly made the city come together. He made our city proud. It was certainly something to be part of, and I really appreciate that, guys, and thank you for letting me be part of that. And in closing, the greatest memory I really had was winning a Golden Gloves title and having that referee raise my arm as champion. I mean, there's no better feeling in the world. It's like a drug, an intoxicating drug or a drink. It made me understand why so many great fighters stay in the game too long. Thank you again for this great honor, and have a great night.
Lou, you're getting fired up talking about Kelly. I thought you wanted to get back in the ring. You sound like you wanted to get back in the ring. I think I mentioned earlier, editing the bios down is sometimes challenging because you want to do justice to all the inductees. For Jim Snowden, football inductee, it was tough. One of the finest football players and all-around athletes ever to come out of the Mahoning Valley. I say it was tough because his accomplishments are just incredible. Graduate of East High School, where he was a three-sport star for the Golden Bears. Jim was all-city series, all-Northeast Ohio in football and basketball, earning all-Ohio honors in both sports as well. In track, he made it to the state in shot put. He left his mark at the state level in three sports, which he competed. Upon graduation, Jim was recruited to play football at Notre Dame, playing fullback, linebacker, and on the offensive line, earning three letters for the Fighting Irish. While there, ironically, he played for three coaches. The 1964 season, probably the most memorable, under then first-year head coach Ara Parsegian. The Fighting Irish went on to have a 9-1 record, finishing third in the nation in the Associated Press rankings, undefeated until the final game of the season, lost to Southern Cal. Prior to that game, they were number one in the country. After leaving Notre Dame, Jim was drafted by both the Washington Redskins of the National Football League and by the Kansas City Chiefs of the American Football League. Jim opted to play in the NFL for the Washington Redskins, where he played for the Redskins from 1965 to 1972, playing in 98 games. He also played for five head coaches in the NFL. Certainly well-deserved under the football induction. Let's welcome Jim Snowden.
Good evening, everybody. I appreciate everybody being here. I'm glad I could make it myself. It's been one hell of a pleasure, I tell you. Believe it or not, I'm not a public speaker at all, believe me. But this is a special occasion. I'm very proud to be here, to be a nominee for the Coach's Corner. They've done terrific, and I appreciate it. Of course, my wife wanted to know why it took you guys so long to get me in there. But Careful. But she's serious too, man. Why? I know everybody's been thanking everybody, but I've got a few people I've got to mention myself. And one of them was my high school coach. His name was DeGregorio, Edward DeGregorio. Would you please stand, coach? I don't know if you can hear me back there. Thanks for being here, Coach. I really appreciate it. I remember something Coach told me a long time ago. We were out on the football field there. He was recruited as a basketball coach here at East High School. And it changed my life after he got there, actually. He could put a game plan together, carry it out, and we'd win. We knew it. And he always gave you words of inspiration. He told me one day out on the football field, he says, Jim, I was playing defensive end at the time, and I came in and made a little move here and move there and tackled a guy, and he ran over to me, grabbed me by my collar. Look, you got to be mean. You got to be mean when you go in. All right, coach, I got you. Of course, a couple years later, I think it was one Sunday afternoon, we were playing the Chicago Bears. And we ran a short screen to the left. I was at left tackle. I was supposed to count to 1,000, 3,000, 4,000, boom, and release and take the first man inside. Like I said, we were playing Chicago Bears. Back in 1960, was it 66 or 67? Middle linebacker, 55. Dick buckets. My sister told me, I don't mean to jump around like this, but my sister was in the room there with us at the end of the game, and she said, Jim, I saw the play, but what happened? She said, your legs look like a what do they call them, a helicopter. It was spinning around. I said, that wasn't half of a guy. I said, I couldn't even see when I got up. If my helmet chin strap hadn't snapped, he'd have broke my neck. I was looking through the ear hole of my helmet. But I've had some experiences. There weren't that many big 300-pound guys at the time I was playing at 225 offensive tackle. But it helped you know the game and how to play it, I tell you. I want to thank the guys that have brought me here, and that's just my classmates, our guys I grew up with and played ball with here in Youngstown. I tell you, there's some fantastic people, good friends to have. I love all of them. Thank you guys for being there for me. And my family's back here, too. It's like a family reunion, class reunion all together for me tonight. It's beautiful. But I am truly grateful for being here tonight. And this honor has been, which has been bestowed upon me, has been, it's just been fantastic. And getting back here to see everybody, it's just been a beautiful day for me. A whole weekend, actually. It's been nice. It's been some dark days there for a while, but coming out of it. And I want to thank the guys for being there with me. All of you, every last one of you. Well, I don't want to forget my wife. This is my best friend, my whole best friend in the whole wide world. And I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for her looking after me, taking care of me. She's been fantastic. Baby, stand up, please. And thank you again from the bottom of my heart for this incredible day. And I'd like to, I never met him, but I heard a lot about him since I've been here. And that's Mr. Mintz, Joe. Bless his family, bless his friends, and everybody that knows him. And I wish I had a chance to meet him. Sounds like a great guy. But thank you again from the bottom of my heart. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Terry Hefke, our lone bowling inductee this year. Terry, a 1998 graduate of Austintown Fitch High School. Terry's bowling career began at the age of 6 at Wedgwood Lanes, and her career has been going strong ever since. Her first adult league in the Youngstown Salem Women's Bowling Association, 1998-1999, she carried a 205 average. The following year, a 210 average, and has been first in high average category for 12 consecutive years after that. Terry's highest average, 242, coming in 2010 and 2011. I think Lou mentioned it earlier, the architect of 65 300 games, rolling back-to-back perfect games on two occasions, 24 800-plus series to her credit, and nearly 400 700-plus series. Her state title came in 2006. She won the Ohio WBA Women's Tournament 2004, 2010, 2012, and by doing so three times, the first ever to win that three times. A champion of the Youngstown Women's Masters and Warren Women's Masters Tournament, she won back-to-back Summit County Queens tournaments, become the first ever to do that as well. She served as the head coach of the Austintown Fitch Falcons girls bowling team in 2001-2002, leading them to the state crown that season. Certainly well-deserving, Terry Hepke.
Hi, Terry. Congratulations.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It's every athlete's dream to excel and have a future in the sport that they love. I happen to be one of those lucky ones. I have been able to live out my childhood dream through the sport of bowling. Coming from a bowling family, bowling was and still is all something I have always loved and enjoyed. My parents saw something in me at a young age and continued to push me to be the best that I could be. They instilled in me that hard work and dedication, determination, and the fight to never give up on what you love would help me reach the goals that I had set for myself and accomplish the things that I thought I could only dream of. They've shown me through bowling and all of my life adventures that when someone believes in you, the sky is your limit. Alongside my parents, I do have a lot of people to thank. I've had support from these people in so many ways over the year. That's my family, my friends that are here, the ones that are not here, my coaches, and the entire bowling community. These people have played such a huge part in the success, whether it was them being there for just for moral support, sacrificing their time to help me improve, pushing me to keep going, picking me up when I was down, or whether it was just to go on trips long hours away from home, just so I didn't have to be alone. Some of these wonderful people are here tonight. Some can only be here in our hearts, but I do want to sincerely thank all of you. The two that I owe this honor to are my parents. My father, if you would please stand. That's my father, Jim Hefke. He's the one that got me started into bowling. And then my late mother, Linda Hefke, who was also my biggest cheerleader. So I do have to say that this induction is not just mine, it's all of yours as well. So I would also like to thank Patty Shuley. She has been there also for me since I was young. She's followed me from when I was a little brat to who I am now. We'll leave it at that. I do have one of my other coaches here too, Artie Burquist. That gentleman right there also helped me, so I'd like to say thank you. Yes. I have Mama Jean Tundola Smith over there, who was also the woman that inducted me into the Ohio State Bowling Hall of Fame, and she was kind of my mama when my mom couldn't be there. And then, of course, my brother, Jimmy, my sister-in-law, Jackie, my niece, Kayla, my nephew Cody, nephew Tanner, and one of my best friends, Stephanie. So thank you to all of you. Thank you to the Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame Committee and the members. And I want to also thank Helene Grand Silrino for her love of the sport and all she has done to make sure it is recognized, not just here, but in the entire valley. So again, thank you to everyone that has been there, everyone that has supported me, everybody that has helped me achieve what I have. I would not have been able to do this without any of you. And congratulations to all inductees in the class of the 2019 Hall of Fame. Thank you.
Thank you. Diane Rapich-Kosko is the lone basketball inductee, a three-sport star at Matthews, graduating in 1988. A four-year letter winner in basketball, she scored over 1,000 points in her career for 3 years, leading Matthews to more than 20 wins. The most memorable season, 1987-88, a perfect 27-0 record, leading her team to the Division III state championships. Diane was all-league, all-county, all-district, and all-state. She would earn a full scholarship to play for Coach Ed DeGregorio at Youngstown State. But before leaving for Youngstown State, she was also an outstanding volleyball player, was a majorette for 4 years, serving as the head majorette her senior season. She played for the Penguins from 1988 to 1992, and for her outstanding accomplishments at Youngstown State, was inducted into the YSU Athletic Hall of Fame in 2002. One of the best three-point shooters in Penguin history. She registered a then-school record of 198 three-pointers on her way to scoring 1,198 points in her career. She ranked third in career assists, third in steals as well. One of the most durable players in school history as well. Diane played in all 111 games she suited up for. That's 103 contests. Also a winner at Youngstown State. The program was 74-37 during her time there, including 24-4 in 1990-1991. She went back, served 2 years as an assistant coach. Now, I know your husband's here, Brian. He played minor league baseball, and your two sons are both place kickers. But I want to be clear, you are the best athlete in the family, without a doubt. Let's welcome Diane Rapich-Kosko.
And I did all that in heels as well. No. My four kids that are here tonight have the timer. We have an ongoing bet to see whether I'm going to make the 2-minute mark, so I better get started, okay? First, Mr. Mike Miller, thank you so much for nominating me. It means the world. Mr. Miller was my volleyball coach and softball coach in high school, and he was not only an awesome coach, but a genuine person, and he still is a genuine person. So Mr. Miller, thank you for not only being a great coach, but a genuine individual, both on and off the court. I appreciate your nomination. Curbstone Coaches Association, thank you to the committee for accepting the nomination. I am honored and I am grateful for being here tonight. I'd like to thank all the coaches, not only Mr. Miller, that have touched my life, and the most important, who is here tonight, Ed DeGregorio. I'm so glad when I heard that you were here this evening. Thank you for everything, for giving me the opportunity to not only play for 4 years for you, but also to coach. The experiences that I developed playing in YSU athletics as a basketball player and an athlete, I am using today in my everyday life, and the memories that I have, I'll be forever grateful to Coach DeGregorio for that, and I'll never forget the day that I signed. Nowadays, you see the signings at school with all the student athletes getting ready for college and all the photographs and everything going on. Coach D did not come to the school. He came to my house and sat with my parents, and I signed there, and that shows you what kind of individual he is and how dedicated he was to the game and how he loved the game. So Coach D, thank you again. And yes, he also told us to be mean on the court, just like he did to you, Mr. Snowden. He continued to tell us that. Also, I want to thank Dennis Holmes and Robert Chalecki, my high school basketball coaches. They both helped guide us to our state championship, as well as the many, many memories that I have through my high school career. Next, my family, who's here tonight. My heroes, the two individuals, are Frank and Mary Rapich. If they could stand for me, please. I know they do not want. They have been so humble. Married 59 years. Thank you. 8 children. I have 4 brothers who I played basketball with every Sunday after spaghetti dinner, and three sisters as well. We are very fortunate that we are all still together. So thank you, Mom and Dad, for everything. And then my wonderful husband, Brian Costco, who on our initial date at the Y playing basketball, walked off very frustrated with me because he did just get beat by a girl. Thanks for being here, babe. Connor and Colton, one a YSU grad, and yes, former football player, and recent, as of Friday, a master's degree student who just received his master's in geology. Colton, a YSU current grad and football player who we're looking forward to watching this fall on the football field. Thanks for coming. And my two wonderful twins, our two wonderful nine-year-old twins, Brooklyn and Brian, who just made their first communion yesterday. Thank you for being here. In closing, again, Mr. Miller, thank you for nominating me. Curbstone Coaches Association, thank you for this honor this evening. And congratulations to my fellow inductees. It's a wonderful night, and I'm really appreciative that we are able to share this together. Thank you.
Up next is Rick King for contribution to sports, but make no mistake about it, Rick was an outstanding athlete as well at Newton Falls, where he earned multiple letters during his career. Four-year letter winner in track and field, was a regional qualifier in the 220-yard dash. Upon graduation, Rick attended Miami University, where he competed in the 220-yard dash and mile relay. Really made his mark at Howland High School, spending decades there, 2008 to 2012, under his direction as athletic director, some of the best teams all around in the Mahoning Valley. Football teams won four straight league titles, earned four consecutive playoff appearances, boys and girls other sports accounting for over 20 AAC championships. Rick, while at Howland High School, served as assistant varsity coach in football, track coach, baseball coach, and serving as freshman basketball coach as well. He was the 8th grade football coach, 7th grade basketball coach, and 7th and 8th grade track coach. In addition to coaching stops with Howland, he served as assistant football coach at Lakeview and McDonald as well. Rick became the commissioner of the All-American Conference in 2012. For contributions to sports, and there were a lot of them, let's welcome Rick King to the Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame.
Thank you, Bob. I stand before you a very humbled person today. Looking at the DS up here and seeing the other individuals, I feel very honored to be among them. A special thanks to the Curbstone Coaches for not only this banquet, but for everything you do on a yearly basis and a weekly basis, and all the people that you've honored through generations. A special thanks to Mr. Meng for being my sponsor and supporting my membership here. Once again, congratulations to all the other inductees. A special thanks to my family members. I have my brother, my sister, my cousin, my wife, one of my grandkids, my stepson Carl, several coaches from Highland, McDonald, and all the other places that my journeys have taken me. As I look around the room, there's many of you that I've crossed paths with, and being involved in high school sports for the last 43 years has been a very rewarding experience. As most coaches, you know, we're big into sayings and that adage, it takes a village to raise a child. I truly believe it takes a village to put us up here. Many people have involved. And I have a lot of people I want to thank. The good news is I'm not going to name them all by name. Okay. Starting with the people from Newton Falls, where I'm a graduate, as Bob said. 55 years ago, I played Little League Baseball, and I had the privilege of playing with Jack Cusick, who became a major league pitcher at the time, and I also had the privilege to play against Reed Lamport and later play high school sports with him. So that group of individuals and that group of athletes in Newton Falls back in the 60s and early 70s, it was a great experience for all of us. After leaving Newton Falls and then going to Miami, I ended up getting my first phone call from Jack Pearson, and Jack is the one that opened the door. He led me on this journey, and through the years, I worked with many great coaches, many great athletic directors, many administrators. And those are the people that guided me, they mentored me, they supported me, They answered my questions. They gave me their knowledge. And somewhere along the way, some of them saw something in me so that later on in my life, I was able to assume some of these leadership positions. And for that, I will be forever grateful. And none of this would have been possible without the athletes that I was able to work with. And being at Highland and Lakeview at McDonald, I was privileged to work with some great athletes, many Big Ten athletes, state champions. But I will never forget each and every one of those athletes, because it's not just about the great ones. It's about the ones that want to be an athlete. They want to be on the team. They want to contribute. And as I've said to many people, I've been a part of many monumental victories. We've also suffered devastating losses. But along the way, we learned and we came back the next day. And as somebody already said, part of the legacy of this Mahoney Valley is our commitment and dedication to sports. And I've been very privileged to be a part of that. And throughout this process, you know, my family has been so supportive from the very beginning. As I get a little bit older now, thank you for the comment about decades here, I think it's five now. You know, I look forward to that next generation. I'm very pleased to say, you know, I'm proud to have five grandchildren. One of them, Zachy's in the back, and to watch them and their involvement in sports. And I hope in some small way, I can be part of what they can accomplish. And that's what I want to do right now. And the last thing I want to say is I want to give a special thanks to my wife, Susan. Thank you for the smile. Without her support, and if you know my wife, Susan, she's very high energy. And you know, when you go to a store and they have that sign, good, better, and best, there is no good and there is no better with my wife, Susan. It's the best. And many times I put a speech together, I came up with something, and I've got, is that the best you can do? Okay, so back to the desk, let's redo it, and let's get it done right. And Zachy, you know Muma there. We're going to do things the right way, and that's the only way we know how to do them. So to all of you, I say thank you very much. I say God bless. And for the younger ones, dream your dreams and keep working, and they can come to fruition. Thank you very much.
I think when we look back on the Jim Tressel era at Youngstown State, we remember a lot of things, including the national championships, but also a long line of great running backs. And one of those great running backs is Leo Hawkins. It began in 1987 at Austintown Fitch. Nine letters during his career there. Track and field, football as well, basketball and wrestling. So respected Leo was at Fitch. He was the captain for the Falcons football team, track, and wrestling teams. In football, he broke the sophomore season rushing record, and during his senior year, broke the program's existing record for yards in a game and a season. At the time of his graduation, Leo was the all-time leading rusher. He was selected All-State in both football and wrestling as a junior, and was named most valuable player of the track team. He led the Falcons to the Still Valley Conference Football Championship as a senior. He was All-Northeast Ohio and first team All-SVC. Also, Leo was named most valuable player of the prestigious North-South All-Star football game. After leaving Fitch, he went on to Youngstown State to play for head coach Jim Tressel, earning three letters for the Penguins and helping YSU to a 12-3 overall mark his senior season in 1991, the first of four 1AA championships in the decade of the 90s. He left Youngstown State with 2,279 career yards and 22 career touchdowns, 19th all-time. Upon completion of his college career, he had tryouts with the Browns, the Bengals, Seattle Seahawks, and the National Football League, and tryouts in the Canadian Football League with Toronto, Hamilton, Argonauts as well. Leo was also a United States Army veteran, a local guy, inducted in the Coaches Hall of Fame, Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame from Austintown Fitch. Welcome back home, Leo Hawkins.
Congratulations. Good evening, everybody. This is going to be short and real brief. I want to thank my parents and friends. I want to thank the coaches of Curbstone for this inductee and all my other classmates of this year. And I want to thank my best friend that's here tonight, Kurt Morgan, and my other best friend, Chrissy Rohan. I want to thank Kurt for pushing me for 3 or 4 years in high school to make me the best player that I am. And I want to thank Coach Hartman of Austintown Fitch. And but last but not least, I want to thank one of the greatest coaches in America, Jim Tressel. He was my mentor and made me the person I am today. Thank you very much.
You look like you could still go out and gain 100 yards in a game. You look good, Leo. Good to see you. Our final inductee, last but certainly not least, is Joe Jeswald. He is one of four football honorees in this year's Hall of Fame class. Joe is a 1972 graduate of Ursuline High School. He was first team All-Still Valley selection, second team SVC his junior campaign as well. Also, Joe was a member of the wrestling team. He was inducted into the Ursuline Athletics Hall of Fame in 1996. Upon graduation, he attended Hiram College, starring for the Terriers at center from 1972 to 1975. For his exploits on the gridiron, Joe was inducted into Hiram Athletics Hall of Fame in 1996. From 1989 to 1994, he was the head coach of the Girard Indians, earning Mahoning Valley Coaches Association Coach of the Year honors his initial season. He repeated as Coach of the Year in 1992. In 1991, Joe led the Indians to their first ever playoff appearance in program history, named Coach of the Year on multiple occasions. From the football field, he went on to administration, assistant superintendent from 2002 to 2004, and superintendent of schools at Girard from 2004 to 2011. He also led the construction of the new Girard Junior Senior High School, and also led the renovation of the new Arrowhead Stadium. I guess you are Mr. Girard. Nick Cochran thinks he is, but I think it's you, Joe Jeswald. Let's welcome Joe Jeswald.
Good evening, everyone. When I came in today, I said there's two things. I don't want to be first and I don't want to be last, but I'm last. That's 50%, so if I was a baseball player, right, John, I'd be batting about 500, make about $100 million a year, so that wouldn't be too bad. I'm sitting here listening to everyone speak, and a couple things come to mind. Primarily that I'm extremely fortunate. I'm extremely fortunate because I've got a tremendous family, many of whom are here tonight, and I've had the privilege and honor of coaching with gentlemen who are among the finest in this area and playing for the best, I think, in this area. To the Curbstone coaches, thank you so much. This is a huge deal. When I came in here, I thought maybe I was prepared, but I realized that I wasn't quite prepared for this. This is extremely flattering, and it's extremely huge deal for me. I'd like to thank my family, beginning with my brother Ken, who nominated me and served as my sponsor this evening. I really appreciate it, Ken. It's great knowing that we'll always be here for each other. For my nieces and nephews who are here tonight, thank you for everything that you have done for me, the support that you have always provided. My mother and father, everyone here has talked about their parents. I'm extremely lucky my mother and father are here, and for all that they've done for Ken and for me, to give us the opportunity to experience the things that we've experienced, to give us an opportunity to get a good education and raise families of our own. My wife, Marcia, who has been with me, as I stop and think now, for nearly 50 years, which is amazing considering we're only 55 years old. For her support, as a number of others have said, it's not possible to do the things we do without someone at home. We're gone a lot, late meetings, late dinners, clinics and such. And we can't do those kinds of things without someone at home who's understanding and supporting and loving you. And here I am, all these years later, still doing that, still putting in that time at a different kind of sport, but she's still understanding. Go back with Marcia and my mother and father-in-law, who are always there for both of us and supported both of us. I played for whom I think are two of the greatest coaches in this area, Ed Klein at Ursuline and Joe Malmazur, God rest his soul, at Hiram. I had the opportunity to coach for and learn from people like Charlie Jamison and Ed Klein, Ed Makovich, and Dave Papata at Niles. See, Chris, I told you I wouldn't forget Niles. So I did have an opportunity to coach there as well. And I had an opportunity to coach with some very close friends who are also outstanding coaches, and they're here tonight. Some of them are here tonight. Gary Ferrando, Joe Capozzello, John Spano. And I also noticed Bob Sanders here this evening as well. Lastly, I'd like to give credit to the kids that I was able to coach, both at Girard and Niles. Similar kids, tough, hard-nosed kids who gave us everything that they had on the field. I'm very proud to be able to coach those kinds of kids. I'm very proud to be able to be here tonight, to have experienced what I have and offered what little I have as well. Lastly, I want to thank Dana and I want to thank Bob, because during my time as a coach, those guys were there. And they've done tremendous things for this community and for the kids who participated in athletics here. Thank you all again.
Welcome, Hall of Fame inductees. You're now part of the enshrinement. We appreciate you being here today. Is there Anthony Traficani here?
Right there to our left.
Anthony, you got something? Come on up.
Anthony, good morning. How you doing?
Come on.
Good. Likewise.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. It's great to be here in front of these honorees and to see that all that you've done in sports and what you've done for our community and hearing the stories and sharing all the events. I actually was a football player and a baseball player in my later years, but nowhere near what you folks have accomplished. I'm here tonight to honor Mr. Hirschback on behalf of the mayor of the city of Youngstown, Jamal Tito Brown, and he has for you a resolution from the city of Youngstown honoring all your contributions that you've made to Major League Baseball. And he also has a key to the city that he asked that I give to you. So if I may do that, is that okay? Sure. On behalf of the mayor of the city of Youngstown, Mayor Jamal Tito Brown, I'd like to present the city key for you, sir, for your accomplishments.
Thank you.
God bless you and your family.
Thank you very much.
Tonight, to meet you. I love you, man. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
God.
You got it.
Thank you so much.
Anthony, thank you. Appreciate it. John, one more piece of hardware. We want to thank you for being our keynote speaker for 2019. You did a wonderful job. Everyone enjoyed you. And on behalf of the Curbstone Coaches, we present this to you.
Thank you. This is absolutely beautiful. I just want to say again, I'm honored to be here, be a part of this organization, and most honored that life brought me, thanks to my wife Denise, and here to Youngstown. Been here 36 years now, and I know it's my home, and to be a part of all you people and the great tradition, the great people that live in this area. Thank you very much.
Just two more items. I'd like to have Pastor Dave come up and for the benediction.
What a great night. Let's bow for prayer. Lord, we do want to thank you so much. As we've witnessed, it's very humbling to hear of all of the accomplishments of these fine individuals, these amazing athletes, these incredible people. God, we pray that you would just continue to bless and use their lives. Thank you again for how they've had such a ripple effect in other people's lives down through the years. And Lord, we'd be remiss not to mention Attorney Joe Maxson, who was so instrumental all through the years, a father to this organization, and his commitment and the value that he has added. Lord, we pray that you would give him rest. And just give him our appreciation tonight as he is home with you. And continue to keep your arms around his family. And we thank you for him and the life that he led and lived. Lord, now just dismiss us with your blessing. We thank you for this night. And I pray that you'd continue to bless this incredible organization of Curbstone Coaches in the Mahoning Valley. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Dave. Thank you. Tomorrow at noon at the Avion, we have our weekly luncheon. We have NCAA official Joe DeRosa speaking. If you want to stick around afterwards, John will autograph your program if you want it. In the fall, when we start meeting again in September for our weekly luncheons, I will put in the papers that applications are being accepted. So my phone number's in there and Helene's number's in there. If you have an applicant you think is Curbstone Coaches Hall of Fame ready, call us. We'll get an application to you and get it right back to us, and we'll see what we can do, okay? Max and family, our thoughts and prayers are with you. I know you got a tough week coming up. Just hang in there. We all love you. I think Joe's giving us a thumbs up right about now for today. Thanks again, everybody. Next year, May 3rd, so we hope to see most here again. Have a great evening, everybody.
Thank you very much. Thank you for everything.